I'm Xenia Montrovido. I see a lot of my students over here. I forced them to be here. I'm from the College of Charleston. So just so you know, if there's a lot of people. So they call me Dr. X because I have a difficult name. And I'm here to talk about security metrics. Is this even possible? Or is it mission impossible? This is an expanded talk I did at a USENIX workshop a year ago. And I really love this topic because my research revolves around this. So who am I? I am from the Ivory Tower. They do allow me to talk to you industry people, actually. So I'm from the College of Charleston, academia, computer science department. I did my PhD in computer networks at North Carolina State University, Wolfpac. And then I was on the dark side for a little while. I worked for IBM for 3 years as a software engineer. And then I switched back with a postdoc at William & Mary. My area of specialization during my PhD was computer networks and performance modeling. My advisor was actually a mathematician, so loads of math. And I also do a few other things other than techie stuff, but that's why do I speak about security metrics today? Because when I switched to something cooler, because I didn't have to do a PhD so I could choose my research, so that was security, I was, I'm not on the camera, huh?
You're good now.
I'm good now. Okay. So I was like, security. It's great, it's fun to hack, it's fun to defend, and I believe that I am in the purple side. I love doing both, defend and hack, and giving a hard time to red teamers that their job is easy, but I don't think it is. But I believe I'm more in the purple side, but security metrics was something that baffled me. Like, you know, we have metrics for performance, very robust, very well accepted metrics, but for security, you know, you ask one person, you get 10 different opinions. So I will give you the motivation of why I'm working on this research, and then prior works on metrics for security, because I really want to open a conversation. And then I won't focus too much on my research, although, you know, I have some ideas and I would like to discuss this with you. So my research is a framework for Internet of Things security, and this is what I'm focusing more right now. Okay, so we have physics envy, I would say, in security, but also in computer science in general, okay? Because, you know, we have the science in our field, but not everything is very robustly measured as in physics. So I just have a physicist here because, you know, metrics are important. We can't improve what we cannot measure. And also, metrics make sense to scientists, okay? So they make sense, they're objective, and all these good things. So what makes a good metric, okay, from the side of the scientist? Okay, I'm not saying from the side of the security person, but in general, a good metric. It's quantitative, okay? This high, medium, low, it's not exactly a number, okay? And industry people know what I'm talking about. So it's quantitative, it's an actual number. It's objective, okay? So it's not the beauty is in the eye of the beholder. It's, this is what it is, okay? It's 42, the answer to the universe and everything. And then it's repeatable and reproducible. That goes back to science. You had to take science courses, unfortunately, and you did these repeatable experiments that could be reproduced if you describe them very well. It's not expensive, it shouldn't be too expensive, and it's universally acceptable. That's a big deal too, right? So outside today, it's 7 Celsius. Celsius, not Fahrenheit. Okay, so from, you know, from when I started this research, I was like, you're going to be the Don Quixote over here. Measuring security is difficult. You cannot measure what does not exist. I started going to different InfoSec meetups and all that, and they were like, no, there's no context, there's that. I heard a lot of complaints, okay? So, but it is difficult to measure security, okay? Because there's a lot of human factors, there's not many standards. It is something, we're trying to measure something that is not there, okay? And we don't, we have a lot of unknowns. So measuring security is difficult. I hope you will agree on that. And now my adapters are dying. There we go. And the landscape is getting complicated. It's not just it's difficult to measure security. security, but it's also complicated. We're getting the new shape of things to come, computer networks, and we have all these things connecting to them. So, you know, it's pretty hard to make it measurable. So I've got something from my research here. I do a lot. I use Shodan quite a lot. So there's something very measurable. All these ports that are open in different devices and all that. But what do they say about the security of the devices? Not that much. Okay. Yes, I can count them 1, 2, 3, and I have the number of ports over here, but not really descriptive. But the landscape is getting complicated. So I hope that I've convinced you that even though it's tough, we should tackle that problem, okay? So we should tackle difficult problems, whether it's interested of academia, and maybe collaborate if possible. So that's a good idea too. Okay, so security metrics and academia. So when we start doing security on something, we do our homework, okay? So we look at what has been done before. So I'm showing you now a little bit of the prior work, some really good studies that I also recommend to read. They're not too dry academic. So Verendelle did a systematic literature review of 30 years of academic research, okay? And he made these groups of how do we approach security metrics in academia, perspective, target, assumptions. But the big gap, the big hole, was validation. So all of us can make up some hypothetical metrics, industry and academia the same, but do we really validate whether they're useful, usable, and all of these good things? Not really. So that was a good conclusion from this survey. Then another academic survey, more recent, that focuses on how can we group different metrics? How can we measure different things? We measure vulnerabilities, we measure defenses, we measure attacks and situations. So that's pretty good work as well. There's a good body of work in attack graphs. How many of you have heard of attack graphs? So this might be a little theoretical, but it did start from NSA and NIST and these organizations. It didn't start from academia. There's a lot of work from George Mason University, Jajodia is the principal investigator, of how many hops does it take to reach your asset. So this is what an attack graph is. And because, you know, they wanted to put some math behind it, what's the probability to reach that asset if you had the graph of your network? So it's really fun work, and actually, believe it or not, part of the federal work, the CVSS, was based on attack graph. So more academic work, lots of simulations. We could do a simulation to measure when an adversary is going to take over a system. And that's the works that I'm citing over here. And maybe even guess about 0 days and all that good stuff. I mentioned, again, if I breathe, my two adapters get upset. Again, the CVSS, which I mentioned, this is more federal, these national organizations that are making those standards. NIST made the CVSS, which is, I don't remember what the abbreviation is right now, so I'm drawing a blank. But it is a standard that industry is using quite a lot, okay? I've heard industry professionals that live by CVSS. And it has a lot of good estimates about this is a high risk of vulnerability, this is a low risk, and all that good stuff. And it also even has these quantitative metrics, these formulas of how did we calculate that this was a high impact threat and all that. But the problem with the high, medium, low is what do you compare it with, okay? So it's the context. So these high, medium, lows and those numbers, where are they coming from? The research is very good. It's not, though, as validated as many industry people have also said that it's not very validated. You may have seen this book. This is more an industry approach, The Security Metrics by Jackwith, and then How to Measure Anything. So I've heard a lot of industry people talking about that. It's industry finds Monte Carlo simulations. Monte Carlo simulations are simulations of rare events, and sometimes, you know, a compromise is quite a rare event. It's not something that happens every day, although more than often it happens nowadays. So there's these two books, and there's a lot of work being done, but still, you know, we don't have one standard. And why? Because there's challenges. There's huge challenges. The scope Defining the scope for a company is very difficult. Everybody has a very different business over here. The business of a school is very different than NYWIC, very different than MUSC, very different than IBM. And so there's issues of scope, standards, because we don't agree easily, verification, how to measure a metric, how to measure how good the metric is, and of course politics. I mean, why should we talk to each other? Why should we agree and things like that? Okay, so now here are my suggestions, and I will try to have at least 5 minutes for questions and also your input. So as I was looking at computer network, I got very excited about the Internet of Things. It was also a cheap way to get a nice test bed and do experiments. Here we go again. So I look at Internet of Things, and the way I start security is from my classes, threat modeling. So who do I trust, who do I not trust, and what do I want to measure? So a little bit of the threat modeling, set up your Internet of Things testbed. This may be the only trust zone, and then things that you don't trust. If you have read, how many of you know the work by Adam Shostak? Pretty well known in Black Hat and all that. So he has written the book on threat modeling, actually. It is quite used in industry. Who of you have heard of STRID? STRID, spoofing, tampering, repudiation, information loss, elevation, denial of service, elevation of privilege. So maybe it's more theoretical than I thought, but Microsoft started it. It's not my fault, okay? So Shostak from Microsoft to his own consulting firm now created this threat modeling, like zones you trust, zones you don't trust. And he supports that you shouldn't threat model by your assets or the adversaries. You should threat model by the application. So putting things in scope. So the application for me is, for example, Internet of Things, common Internet of Things that you have at your home. And then we can build from there. So the Internet of Things pose new challenges for metrics. Besides that, they are connecting to the network, so I could use the attack graphs and all of these things that are out there for network security evaluation. They also have sensors and actuators. Lots of engineering over there, and they're very variant. They're not like PCs or Macs, and so there's no easy way of measuring and standardizing what they do. I'm just showing now how I started thinking about this problem. And because I'm Greek, I thought about Socrates. And first, know thyself, your devices and applications. So that's the framework that I looked at. Let's look at the Internet of Things. Let's systematize them, know them as best as we can. Know thy enemy, even though this is not the best way to model your threats, because you don't know what you don't know, and the enemy can be a wide unknown, but there are ways to study them. And then, of course, know thy metric, evaluate your metrics. So this is what I'm suggesting, the system under test and the models over here. So I started my research with a taxonomy, getting to know the Internet of Things. Okay, there's a lot of Internet of Things taxonomies out there. That's why I named the paper not just another Internet of Things taxonomy. And again, the whole purpose was we would verify everything we did, whether with experiments or with a robust mathematical proof, something that would, you know, make people accept that it actually works, whether it's a real test or a proof. So that's what we did with the taxonomy. We proved with set theory the completeness and the correctness of this. And of course, it could be a wrong proof, but we got published, so I would say it's right. And this is what it looks like. Okay, it's a generic taxonomy of things. Okay, but all I wanted to see is how can I map, how can I systematize the application of IoTs and then measure how secure they are. So this is what it looks like. And my students over here said we should classify a smart TV. So this is what we're doing. We're classifying it as a non-mechanical. It's not moving. It has a single channel of communication and so on and so forth. So you can see now things may be clicking as we could measure these things. And if we limit the scope of the application, maybe we can make an algorithm for metrics. So based on this, I have started studying security metrics for Internet of Things for their purpose. There could be so this is a laundry list, actually, and I can bring it back if you want to discuss this and all that. This is something that I'm suggesting, and I didn't pull it out of my head. I pulled it out of this taxonomy. So I'm trying to systematize the way we're doing metrics. And actually, I'm going to use experiments to verify whether these metrics work. So you can see some metrics also that are common, like password guessability, time to guess, or entropy. You may have heard of that, how much information you have to extract. So I am using some metrics that exist out there, but combining them for the IoT ecosystem. Some metrics for communication. This is where the background of queuing theory, which is what I did for high-speed networks in my PhD, could work very well because it's all about communication. Like you lose information, you tamper with that information, and we can evaluate this pretty objectively and quantitatively. And then there's mobility, which is very much an engineering thing. The Internet of Things can move. It could be a mechanical arm or some other device, and that goes more to engineering. I haven't looked at the mobility metrics yet, but this is going to be an interesting thing because they can move on their own or by moving them, like my Fitbit moves with me. And so the models that the engineers are using are random, geographic, and social to evaluate mobility and if it's serving its proper purpose. I'm not going to linger too much in the models that we made for Internet of Things, but they're very, even though they look very mathematical, they're very simple and they're verifiable. So what we did, and so I'm not going to insist on the math, I'm going to insist on what the student did to verify that these models are actually real. He got command line access on a web camera and he actually monitored processes and verified that the state that he believed that the normal operation of an Internet of Things device should go through were correct. And through that, we can look at deviations from this normal operation and define our metrics. So with that, again, there's lots of details to these projects that I'm not going to go in. I'm going to say a little bit about the adversary. So security metrics is about what we don't know. And so it's very tough to say we're 90% secure or there's a probability of 50% of us getting compromised at some point in time if we don't know the adversary. So it's about forecasting, but also about skills and maybe setting benchmarks. So this is what I was using as a performance engineer when I had to break machines and show their limits of performance. There was a 30-year spec type of standard. So then we have challenges for modeling the adversary. The challenges are the features, the time, the accuracy, and the lack of data. That's the biggest challenge, actually, accuracy and lack of data. So we don't know much, but we do have some wonderful people that are doing cyber defense competitions, and they are red teamers. So these are those people that can give us some great data. So at some point, I was like, how do we study that adversary to make metrics, to automate measuring security? Well, there's a wealth of data from these competitions. This is not from our local cyber defense competition, so it's not Ryan's work, but it is from the Western, it's going on and off, over and over. So it's from the Western cyber defense competition. We're talking about terabytes of data of red teamers attacking blue teamers, the colleges, the poor colleges that are suffering. But the data is unlabeled. So we got this data, and with domain knowledge, we labeled it. The tool is on GitHub for anyone that would like to use this. And the student that did this work has got now labeled packet captures with adversarial behavior for which we used the attack framework to make some, again, forecasting models, or maybe an AI that would replay in a very creative way those tactics, and at the end evaluate the security of a system. So you could even measure the adversary, of course, by using their effort, their time, their technical expertise, but also human factors. So this is another security type of metric and all that. I'm saying about Internet of Things, so I tried to study the adversary in terms of Internet of Things also. So the Mirai botnet was the perfect choice. I got some data in my hands from the Mirai botnet. Again, a good chunk of big data. And what I did was I looked at how malware propagates, and now I'm currently looking at mutations and different metrics for malware, but also different ways that this can become an issue with Internet of Things devices. So almost at the end, what's the method, scope, goals, criteria, and techniques? I think this is wrapping up what I've said already. We need to know what we want to model. I have some suggestions for time and spatial metrics, but at the end of the day, I want to focus on simulating, experimenting, and proving that these metrics are good, and even studying you guys and seeing why you use something over another thing and why you consider it more useful. And with that, I will conclude with, yes, it's difficult. Yes, we have disagreements, but we can all agree to disagree, and we can all work together to make a security metrics framework. And definitely the goal is to an algorithm to derive metrics, first for IoT, maybe later for more generic sites. So it's 10:53. We have 7 minutes for questions. So I'm expecting the students to ask a lot of questions. And if you want more details in the projects also, I'm happy to discuss those.
So if we want to learn more about modeling adversaries, where should we look?
So that's a very, very good question. So MITRE, so I use the ATT&CK framework from MITRE, so that's a very good start. I would say try to get the data set that I'm talking about is public. I'm happy to share the code that labels it, actually, and then you can see their tactics from these types of labels, then you can do your Python or Splunk or whatever you want to do on it. I would say these are the ways that I have in my hands. Of course, there's companies that I know that are studying the dark web and all that, but to me, it's all about the network and the packet captures and their technical abilities. It's not so much about what they're talking about or, you know, what they do as humans. But MITRE and then data sets that are out there, and there are some, so, and I'm happy to share more, so. No books that I would recommend.
We have a ton of adversary data, but how do we slice it? What should we be looking for that can help the rest of the industries?
Okay, so I look for an attack from the beginning to the end and different branches. So I consider an attack a decision tree, for example, and I like to see what are all the possibilities that they could take, and then I would like to see what's the probability of them taking one path over another path. So that would be a very good approach to make, let's say, if you want to make an AI of adversaries, that could be a very good way of doing things. I also would like to look at the human side of adversaries, but studying humans is more difficult. It takes time. So I do this for education, but students take my classes, so it's a very easy way to ask them questions and all that. Taking a red teamer that gets paid, you know, $300 per hour, and telling them, oh yeah, I need to interview you to see how you're thinking and your tactics and all that, it's much, much harder. There is a body of work being done right now, but it's again from competition. So I have a colleague actually that she's doing human studies at cyber defense competitions, and she's looking at what would they do and how are they thinking. It's more qualitative than quantitative, but it's very hard to study those adversaries this way.
So earlier you said that a good metric had a problem being universally acceptable. So I was about to ask, how does something, how is it qualified as universally acceptable? What are the possible exceptions to that?
like I said, Celsius. So it's accepted as the standard, the unit for measuring something. And how do we make it actually, and even more, you know, a question that I would like, this is a very good question because people use it, right? So I say I use entropy for password guessability. But then Steve, that is from industry, he says, no, I'm not using entropy. This is too theoretical and all that. And I don't like this. You know, I'm going to use password length because it makes more sense for me and my teammates. And guess what? It may not be as useful to calculate information entropy. So so it's also how much it's used. So something is used. The physics metrics, for example, everybody uses the same. Bandwidth. Latency in computer networks is accepted by all of us, right? But when it comes to passwords or malware, we don't have one way of saying this is the worst malware, or this is we don't have a way of measuring how bad it is. So to make it universally acceptable, we need to have buy-in, and I think we also need to have proofs that things work. So I think that this is one of the biggest things that I've been seeing through the study. The question.